National Legal Services Authority
provides competent advocate in legal proceedings.
All possible legal help and advisors when you need the most.
Does speedy settlement of long pending cases through Lok Adalats.
And that too, absolutely free of cost.
National Legal Services Authority, better justice, better society.
For more information, contact Legal Services Authority office in the nearest court.
Or call the toll free number 15100. Our path to justice now so easy.
Once again, we welcome one and all to our program, Legal Hints. The topic we are going to talk about today is right to education. The person who will enlighten us on this topic is Mr. Noor Khan, the Member Secretary of Meghalaya State Legal Services Authority. Thank you, sir. So, sir, can you briefly tell us about the legislative history of this act?
See, the genesis of the right of children to free and compulsory education 2009 Act was in the decision of the Honorable Supreme Court in Unikrishnan versus State of Andhra Pradesh 1993 1 SEC 645. The Honorable Supreme Court held that the citizens of the country have a fundamental right to education. The said right flows from Article 21 of the Constitution of India. This right, however, is not absolute right. Its content and parameter have to be determined in the light of Article 45 and 41 of the Directive Principle of State Policy. In other words, every citizen, that is including child, of this country has a right to free education until he completes the age of 14 years. Thereafter, his right to education is subject to limits of the economic and development of the state. After this decision, Article 21A was inserted in the Constitution of India by 86th Amendment Act 2002, wherein it provides a compulsory education to children of the age of 6 to 14 years in a manner as the state by law provides. Now, this was the decision of the Honorable Supreme Court, and it was a landmark decision. In this decision, prior to this decision, right to education was incorporated in the Directive Principle of State Policy, but the Supreme Court read that right to education flows from Article 21, and then right to education is a fundamental right. Now, after this decision, the Law Commission and the recommendation of the Standing Committee of the Parliament proposed a bill to amend Part 3 of the Constitution, where in the amendment they wanted to include right to education as a fundamental right. Further, they wanted the amendment in Part 4, that is Directive Principle of State Policy, to include that it will be duty of the parents to impart education to the children. And the most important thing is that fundamental duty also was proposed to be amended by including the responsibility of the parents to impart education. Now, the bill received an assent of the Parliament on 12-12-2002 and was published in Official Gazette on 13-12-2002. And an amendment was brought by 86th Amendment Act 2002, and Article 21A was inserted in the Constitution of India. And after the insertion of Article 21A, right to education for a child from 6 years to 14 years has become a fundamental right. And after this Article 21A was inserted, it became imperative to enact a law to implement the constitutional mandate of Article 21A of the Constitution of India. Accordingly, right of children to free and compulsory education bill was introduced in the Parliament and received the assent of the President on 28-8-2009, and that's how this act came to be.
All right, sir. So what is the aim and object of this act?
You see, basically this act intend to achieve universal education and free universal education for the children. As you know, in a context of a democratic form of a government, which depends for its sustenance upon the enlightenment of the populace, education is one of the social and political necessity. Even several decades ago, our leaders had harped upon universal education as a desideratum for the national progress. It is rather sad that in this great land of ours, where knowledge first lit its torch, where human mind soared up to the highest pinnacle of wisdom, the percentage of illiteracy should be appalling. Today, the frontiers of knowledge are enlarging with the incredible swiftness. Foremost need to be satisfied by our education is, therefore, the illiteracy which persists in a depressing measure. Any effort taken in this decision cannot be deemed to be too much. Now, from these children only we find our future statesmen, leaders, bureaucrats, judges, politicians. So the quality of education will determine the future of the nation. So it becomes very important that it's not all about imparting free education, but it has to be a quality education. That is why the Act emphasizes on the quality of education of those children who are disadvantaged, who cannot afford. Basically, the object is to see that there should be no barrier, and more importantly, financial barrier in education of children.
So, sir, is this act applicable to all schools?
No, that's a very important question. You see, whenever any act is passed, a lot of things are not foreseen. So that is how it, and then these questions are thrown to the, or it goes through judicial review. Now, this question was posed, rather the validity of the act was challenged in a case, that is Society of Unaided School versus State of Rajasthan, that was reported in 2012, volume 6, SEC, page 1. Now, there the question, under this act, section 2N defines school, and it includes, though it gives different categories of school. There is one category of school is that school which receives grant in aid by the government. And then the other categories are those schools who partly receive grant in aid by the government for running the institutions. Now we have some schools established under Article 30 of the Constitution. These are the schools established based on for promoting certain religion and language. These are called the minority schools. Then these schools also, they receive grant and aid by the government. But there are some schools, they don't receive any grant and aid from the government. But it doesn't mean that they are not under control of the government. They require affiliation from the government, the recognition from the government. So the government has got twofold role. One is to grant affiliation to the schools. Second is to grant aid, the financial assistance to the school. Now there was a resistance from the schools for making this act applicable to those schools who does not receive grant in aid. Now, if those schools who do not receive grant in aid, they never wanted that these they should be burdened with this act. Now, in this decision, the Supreme Court held that Article 21A, which was inserted by 86th Amendment, it cast an obligation on the state to provide free and compulsory education to the children of the age of 6 to 14 years and not on unaided non-minority and minority education institutions. Right of children to free and compulsory education guaranteed under Article 21A and Right to Education Act can be enforced against school defined under Section 2N of the Act, which I spoke. But exception was carved out. Unaided minority and non-minority school not receiving any kind of aid or grants to meet their expenses from the government or local authorities. So these schools were excluded. Now, it also said that since education has to do something with the society as a whole, it's a public duty.
So what do we understand by free and compulsory elementary education for children?
You see, this is the, again this term, free and compulsory elementary education. Now, these are different terms, you know. The word compulsory education connotes that the appropriate government is under the statutory obligation to provide and to ensure admission, attendance, and completion of elementary education. Now, what is elementary education? Elementary education is education from class 1 till class 8. And free education means no child other than child, here the exception has been carved out, means, I repeat again, means that no child other than a child who has been admitted by his or her parents to a school which is not supported by the appropriate government shall be liable to pay any kind of a fee or charges or expenses which may prevent him or her from pursuing him and completing elementary education. It means the parents, they have the liberty. Parents who have got the means, they can admit their children in any schools. So, but those parents who cannot afford, they are under the duty, obligation to admit the children and to ensure that they complete elementary education, that is from class 1 to 8.
So, sir, what about those children who are below the age of 6 years?
Yes. You see, that was the amendment which was brought in part 4, Directive Principle of State Policy, after the Uni Krishna's case. Article 45 also provides that they should take care of the children who are below the age of 6 years. Under the Act, Section 11 provides, preparing the children, the state will take initiative to prepare the children who are above the age of 3 years till they attain the age of 6 years for a preschools. So it is the responsibility of the state, Section 11 takes care that for those children who are below the age of 6 years, prepare them for the elementary education. And they can set up some preschools, the government can set up some preschools for these children.
So, sir, how do we establish before the appropriate authority that he or she is a child?
Yes, Section 13 and Rule 14 of the Act provides that the birth certificate will be an evidence of the date of birth of a child and that he can be considered to be a child. But under Section 13, you'll see under Section 13, under no circumstances a child can be deprived of admission if under Section 14 it says that no child shall be denied admission in school for lack of age proof. Now there might be some instances, because what this Act tries to cater is these children who have been deprived of this basic right of education. Most of the time these children are from very remote areas. So in those places you may not have, these children may not have any documents of their birth certificates. So under these circumstances the rule prescribes that, you know, there might be some evidence of those local hospitals, any evidence of the local authorities, all those people who carry out the childbirth in the rural areas, their evidence also will be a good evidence to show that he or she is a child.
So now, what is the responsibility cast upon parents under this Act?
You see, Article 21A makes elementary education of a child mandatory. Whenever there is a right, there is a duty also. So it is the duty of the parents, Section 10 of the Act, as well as the Directive Principle of State Policy, cast a duty on the parents to ensure that they provide elementary education, they admit the children to school, and ensure that they attend the school and complete their elementary education. So it is the duty of the parents, and Section 10, it casts this duty on every parents, because you see, it's a very interesting situation. this right has been conferred upon child. But we cannot say that this right is on the child and there will be a duty on the child. It's the person who is responsible for the child. That is why the Act says not only the parents, even the guardians, they are responsible to ensure that these children or ward, they are admitted and they pursue their elementary education in the neighborhood schools.
So this is a very much talk about when we talk about the right to education. This, can a child be detained while they were pursuing elementary education?
You see, there was an amendment, the section 16, prior to the amendment, it provided that no child should be detained. But an amendment was brought in 2019, and after the amendment, we find that they can hold an academic examinations, yearly examination for promotion. But after the amendment, they say that a child can be detained in class 5 and class 8 if he fails to do well. But before he is detained, he will be given an opportunity to do well in a period of 2 months and to prove that he has accomplished his studies in that standard class 5 and 8. And then he can be promoted. But prior to the amendment, no, the child could not be detained. But after the amendment of 2019 in section 16, a child can be detained in class 5 and in class 8.
So under this Act, it also states that the child or the parent needs to undergo interview or screening tests.
No, you see, under this Act, we find that there's two important issues. One is that we call it the capitation fees. You might be aware about the capitation fees, which is always talked about in some private institutions. And a lot of parents, they are very aggrieved about those interviewing a child. Now, under this Act, you find Section 13. It restricts Section 13 of the Act. Provides, you have to understand what is capitation fees. Here we are talking about free education, means no fees. But still this Act restricts or bars capitation fees. Capitation fees is any payment other than fees in the form of a donation. That is restricted, not only restricted, it is penal. Now any person taking capitation fees means donation, any institution or schools taking capitation fees, which means other than the fees in the form of a donation, those schools receiving capitation fees may be penalized, or they can be punished with a fine which may extend 10 times of the amount.
So what is the role and contribution of Meghalaya State Legal Services Authority in the implementation of this Act?
You see, Meghalaya State Legal Services Authority supports all social legislations, and the noble aim and object of the Act is to see that we universalize education among children. The State Legal Services Authority had launched a campaign which is Opening Door for Education on 11th December 2019. Basically, the idea of this campaign is to bring back those dropout students back to school. We are working close coordination with all the stakeholders, education department, social welfare department, the local heads, to identify the dropout students. The first phase is to identify the dropout students. And after identifying them, we, you know, admit them back in school. And we also monitor that they complete their elementary education. Now, the challenging task is to identify this dropout children. Basically, the primary reasons for the dropout is that poverty. So we have to give them some incentive to see that these children, they come back to school, like midday meal and some other incentives. What we have achieved to date is that we have been able to identify 7,261 dropout children, out of which 2,449 are female and 4,812 are females. So we'll be in the next phase, we'll be admitting them in the school, as the Act itself provides that the education department does the mapping of schools to find out which are the areas which requires schools. So this is the this is how we have made some kind of intervention.
Our talk will not be complete if we don't talk about this ongoing lockdown and pandemic. So, sir, what do you have to say on these online classes during this time?
You see, this is something which we have never seen, that, and we never expected that we will be facing with such situations. But yes, one of the biggest drawback of the online classes, you might have come across a study that, it's not all about online classes. It's something more than that. Are these children having the means for the online classes? You see, for making an online classes successful, what are the things we require? We require smartphones. We require access to internet. We require the knowledge to deal with those electronic device. Now we find there has been instances reported where the young children, they had committed suicide for not being able to have access to these online classes. They became so frustrated and depressed. And what were the reasons for that? The reasons being that in rural areas, they can't afford. As per the study, it is found that out of 8 students, one student has gotten access to smartphone. And most of the students, either they depend on the parents' smartphone. So, the gadgets, the knowledge of using the gadgets, the affordability of these gadgets, it's something which is a serious impediment. Then if we don't look at this problem from this perspective, what happens is that those people who can't afford these gadgets, they'll be deprived.
True.
And finally, we see that even the power, we require electricity. So all those infrastructure, if it is not available to the children, it becomes very difficult. And as per the report, only 50 around above 57% people, 57 people percent of these children, they don't have access to it. So it is a big challenge. And online classes, or what we call as the virtual classes, yes, we don't have choice. If you want to continue with this education of these children, we have to find out ways and means. One of the ways and means is this virtual classes, online classes. But this is a serious drawback. What we see is that they're not being able to have access to it. Because we were never prepared for this online classes. You talk about the parents, you talk about the teachers, you talk about the institutions, you talk about the infrastructure, you talk about the kind of gadgets which are involved in it. So all these things needs to be taken into consideration. What I feel is that, you see, since right to elementary education is a fundamental right, some steps has to be taken to see that, some connection has to be built up between the students and the institutions.
True. Thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us on this topic. I would also like to tell our viewers to take all the points, because this is a very important topic, very important points. It has been updated. The Act itself has been updated, and we need to keep up with it. So, only this much. Thank you so much. Until we meet again.